the presentation of Madalena Peju from Trieste. And yeah, Madalena, you can start.
Thank you. Okay, so I hope everybody can hear. So in this, so today I will speak about our multiple scattering simulation applied to systems that present low Z materials. These materials are very important nowadays because there are a lot of technological applications. And I will spend some time to explain the experimental part of these techniques, and in particular which kind of properties we use of the synchrotron radiation, and then I will list a case system of our work performed in the last decades with Maurizio Benfanti. So, nanostructure materials, as you know, are quite useful nowadays. The reason are functionalization. They can be engineered in different topics, in different issues. Sorry. Okay. Now, the main question, simple question, are how is the structure? Where are the atoms when I functionalize the materials? And what happened to electron, to the optoelectronic properties and also magnetic properties? The industry use, for example, molecules or nanoparticles as building blocks, and different aspects of this engineering is quite important, and a fine characterization of these materials is mandatory. Just to remind you, the X-ray absorption. If we perform a transmission experiment, meaning we have a slide of sample and the synchrotron light in tangent to the sample, we can measure the transmission of the as a function of the photon energy, scanning the photon energy. So typically we have, at depending on the element in the materials, we can get these edges that are typical of the element, as you know quite well. In the transmission, what we measure practically is the absorption coefficient. And in case of transmission, this is a good measure of the absorption coefficient. It can be related in a way, in a simple way, with the calculated cross section and absorption coefficient in terms of Green function or whatever, depending on the framework we want to use. Historically, as you know, the different edges are called in different way, either A edge, L edge, M edge, and so on, or that are related to the different electronic state of the element. This is just to make clear. So we will treat in this talk the 1SK edges and also some words we will spend on the L3 edges in case of transition metal. Now, what normally is used in case of soft X-ray edges is the fact that the absorption coefficient is proportional also in other detection way, because we leave a hole in the system and we promote an electron that afterward decays in different way. So we can use fluorescence detection, where we detect fluorescence photons in the recombination of the hole. We can use the electron yield, meaning either measuring the current or and some derivative of the current, because the hole is recombinated, or we can use also emission. Why I say that? Because different instruments are involved in the different detection modes, and also, as you see, this is the transmission. Here I have something that measure electrons, or I can measure current, or I can use a detector of fluorescence photons in the decay. Why is so important? Because the sampling depth, the detection depth inside the sample change depending on the detection mode. Here is an example of an edge of the carbon K edge of silicon carbide in a zinc blend structure. This sample has been exposed to air. So we have that if we use the total electron yield, we have these edges, while this line shape is strongly changed if I use Auger yield. That's why, because in case of Auger yield, we are sensitive to the last two topmost layer of the sample, while in the total yield, we are sensitive to an order of magnitude more of sample. Object. In case of fluorescence yield, normally we get a sensitivity to bulk configuration of the edge, because we are more sensitive to up to let's say order of magnitude 100 nanometer micron, depending on the edge and on the sample. So that's why it's important to understand that. I remind you, because it's important, especially for systems that involve molecules, that actually we have two different frameworks to model the absorption coefficient. As you know, and your school is devoted to this, the Green function and the multiple scattering can be used in real space to simulate the photo-emitted electrons, and the model is that these photo-emitted electrons interact with the surrounding by means of multiple scattering around the sample with the nearest neighbor and also a longer diameter. But also we can use the energy space, let's say, and model the transition as transition from the core level, or so a filled electronic state, up to the empty state, above the Fermi level and above the continuum. A unified model has been analytically proved in the late 86 by Rino Natoli and Maurizio Benfatto. And actually, if you see now the literature, people very simply change framework speaking of fine structure X-ray absorption. It's important to understand that in this case we speak of orbitals or block state, while in this case we speak of scattering. What is the very empirically speaking? We have resonances where we have a maximum of the density of state. That is approximately how we experimentally see the features in the X-ray absorption. Another point, and this is quite important, is the fact that in depending on the element and on the core level excited, different lifetimes are present. And in particular for light set elements, we need high photon flux, but the details of the fine structure of the spectrum is very, very clear in a way. This is quite an example. We will speak later, we will discuss this sort of molecules. This is a porphyrin. Porphyrins are quite important from the technological point of view because are naturally photovoltaic and are also the molecules that are very important in the oxygen exchange in life. Anyhow, we have typically these are formed by a microcycle where a central electron, central transition metal is present in the middle of the molecule. that is surrounded by four or more, depending on the molecules, nitrogen, and all around there are the carbon and the hydrogen. The functionalization of these molecules, so the technological point of view of these molecules, is how this surrounding is formed. Anyhow, in case of the microcycle, here I compare nitrogen KH, that is at 400, approximately at 400 electron volt, with the zinc KH, that is at about, take place at about 10 kilo electron volt. As you see, the lifetime is different, so the details are quite different. So here I can follow the details of the say density of state, or if you want, multiple scattering proceed along, let's say, focusing different transition, different resonances, while in case of zinc, the lifetime over details of the features. So the density of state is the same, but the lifetime over, in case of hard disks, the details. And this is something that we have to take. So again, just to fix the idea, here we have a typical edge. The first part is the nexus, where we see the transition related to, for example, the orbitals of the molecules. We can also see a scattering induced by the photo-emitted electrons with a specific wave function. Increasing the photons, so we have the region of exile where mainly single scattering processes take place, where practically the framework in the real space and scattering is more comfortable. And here again, fix the idea. This is how we can make a model of the potential of a typical molecules, for example, CO or oxygen or whatever. Here we have something that can be modeled by the Muffin potential. There are the different orbitals in the case of molecules that are filled. And then above the Fermi level, we have the unoccupied bonded state, and then we have the state of the continuum. Typically, the state between the Fermi level and the vacuum level pi, meaning they have a directional bond, a directional orbital, spacely, and then in the continuum quite often we have sigma orbitals, meaning something that is more delocalized and has a symmetry that is more closer to let's say a sphere. This is very, very roughly speaking, but just to fix the idea. Now, what about light Z? As you see, we have seen the details of the local density of state of light Z elements is important. The typical example is the carbon. Carbon can form several allotropic structure that correspond to different electronic configuration or hybridization of orbital, as you like. What happened to the nexus? Nexus, this is a quite old example provided by the Nexus book of that you can find in the literature. Anyhow, we have a diamond, have something that has these features that are here, but start after this level that is approximately the point where the binding energy has the Fermi level. So this is the local density of state of the empty state. If we have the graphite, meaning where we have a different hybridization and the pi states, orbitals are orthogonal to the plane of the graphite, the line shape is completely different. We have pi resonance that is here, and this is the part of the sigma resonances. So really a huge change in the line shape. Basically easy, simple molecules like benzene form orbitals, and actually either in gas phase experiment or in films or solid state aggregation, you find again these resonances that are practically below the vacuum level and between the Fermi level and the vacuum level. This is, I select another example. This again, this is the graphite. And these are the Fullerenz C60, that is a ball, the DC70, that is a GEC, and the single wall carbon nanotube. As you see, the changes in the light shape are quite important. I show here also inverse photoemission measurements of the same system. That's why, because inverse photoemission is another technique where the core hole is not formed, and practically here in first approximation we have the spectra that are related to the conduction band or empty orbitals of the system. And as you see, again we have a change because carbon has this peculiarity, but the spectra are different. Are different because in this case I can figure out the spectra inverse photoemission as simulated by the ground state. These are the old DFT calculation, but they are nicely reproduced the feature of this state, and also can simulate modeling the core hole in the core level of carbon 1s, the carbon KH nexus, and as you see, explain why these spectra are different each other, but they are so sensitive to the surrounding. Now, it's important to stress that this is a peculiar example. The carbon KH nexus is very difficult to be simulated properly, either with DFT, but also with multiple scattering, because the details of the potential actually are quite important. Before to go to the application of MXAN and multiple scattering, I want just to show another problem, another issue that we have in the soft X-ray. Meaning this is a typical layout of a beamline in the soft X. So we have different elements. The main point here is that the mirrors, the monochromators, and so on, has surfaces where we have carbon, oxygen, and maybe also nitrogen. So that means that we have holes correspondence in the I0, so in the light that is transmitted and arrived to the samples, also in the flux of photons that impinge onto the sample and that we use to measure our edges. This is not so crucial in the hard disks, because even though the mirrors and the optics of the beam lines present these structures, so these holes in the flux, these are not so heavy. For example, in case these are different beam line all around the world, but as you see, carbon can change also and have this hole that can be one order of magnitude with respect to the surrounding the other part of the flux. So it's a real important issue that has to be take into account in the analysis of the raw data to get the absorption coefficient, let's say. Another important issue, I think a colleague has shown something about XAS applied to magnetic system and XMCD that show the dichroism in case of different magnetic elements, iron, cobalt, and so on and so forth. Anyhow, one of the properties of the synchrotron radiation is the fact that you can control the polarization of light, typically in the low Z but magnetic system. We use the linear, natural linear polarization of the synchrotron light, so we know the direction of the E vector of the impinging light, while, and can also change in circular left, right, and so on. But anyhow, we'll treat the linear polarization of the synchrotron radiation or the impinging light that provide the information about the, for example, orientation of the molecules or the anisotropies of the system. So you can. That's why NEXAFS in the last 20 years has been used for orientation of molecules absorbed onto surfaces, even without calculation, because it's easy to see this difference. And this is an example. Here we have a molecule of CO. A molecule of CO, for example, has the pi orbitals that is orthogonal to the axis, and the sigma that is along the axis, that is clear. So if we impinge with the synchrotron light normally to the surface, this pi features is increased because, very roughly speaking, E vector induce easily transition in that involve this state. So this state is amplified in a way. Or if you want, in the scattering features, the scattering along the E vector is in a way focused, let's say. While this state is very much reduced if we change and the direction of the E vector is not along the pi state, and the other way around happen with the sigma state. Okay, so this is the experimental part, and in a way synthesize what is the background of our work about nanostructure low Z system. As you have seen in previous talk by Maurizio Benfatto, MXAN works by comparing and fitting either structurally or relating to the potential a spectrum, an NEXAFS spectrum. And this is just to remind you what happened when you use the fit procedure in MXAN. I think you have this afternoon some application of this. And here, these are examples of what we can do. This is an old work, but I think is useful. Here we compare the fluorescence yield, meaning of silicon carbide in the diamond or zinc blend, if you like, feature that is highly isotropic, with the spectra taken at different angle of the impinging light onto the it's called 6H silicon carbide, meaning we have a rhombohedral structure where we have an axis, C-axis, a cell of the material that is quite long with a C-axis that about 15 angstrom, and this depends on the mutual orientation of the basic cell of interaction between carbon and silicon that is a trihedral. So changing the trihedral orientation, you can get very highly anisotropic material. And these are the spectra. As you see, the states change very clearly. And we tried to simulate the spectrum, and actually we succeeded. Why I stress this? Because the Muffetin approximation in case of low Z material is really rough. So we want to test if the approximation used in the calculation of the potential was a useful tool to simulate even carbon KH in materials. And as you see, we practically succeeded. These are not broadened properly, but just to give you an idea, here is the spectrum, that one that I showed you before, of the silicon carbide in isotropic structure, meaning the diamond structure. And as you see, we managed to calculate and simulate the main feature of the structure of the silicon carbide, the carbon KH. Here is one of the spectra of the silicon carbide in the rhombohedral structure. As you see, actually, we managed to simulate by MXAN the spectrum. I have to stress here that in this case we didn't fit the structural part because it was well known and we performed the diffraction, so we knew the structure, but we fit the parameter of the calculation. This is it. But in any case, we succeeded. I have to admit that, for example, for graphite, the simulation, we didn't succeed. So the I think that the structure of the graphite that is lamella, that is in plane and so on, is too far away from the muffin tin configuration to be properly modeled. But in case of a solid, we managed. Another example that comes, this is again an old work, where we succeeded in simulated light set, in this case oxygen, and oxygen is simpler with respect to carbon, oxygen and nitrogen, is the simulation of the molecular superoxide, alkali superoxide. This these materials has this sort of structure. This is like the calcium fluoride, where we do not have single oxygen, but the oxygen maintain its molecular configuration, but change charge with respect to the molecule of oxygen. And here, these are the spectra. Superoxide of potassium and cesium are quite similar. In any case, we can distinguish this part that is the pi of the O2 minus and the sigma orbital of the sigma minus. As you see, I use the framework of orbital when I qualitatively want to understand the spectra. So the main part is the anion configuration of the oxygen. So we performed self-consistent calculation in case of this anion, and we see that changing the distances in this molecule, we change position of the pi and sigma, resonances. So this is a quite important point of view, because this is a well-known effect and we were able to simulate. Then we applied this, you know from the Benfatto talk, the muffin potential, and we played with the muffin tin, either calculating the muffin tin or artificially change the muffin tin, the zero the muffin tin, in order to see if MXAN could simulate the pi resonances, meaning resonances below the continuum region. And actually we succeeded, and this was checked by the self-consistence, was also calculated by means of MXAN. Details you can ask to Maurizio this afternoon. And as you see, we were able to simulate the main feature of this feature, that is the potassium superoxide. If we use the oxygen-oxygen distance of this small part of the cell, meaning the oxygen, the O2 anion. If we remain with the distance of 1.4, the spectrum practically does not fit at all. While if we change and we play with this and we fit practically the distance, oxygen distance in the charge state, so we impose an ionization of this group of the oxygen as -1, and we will manage to improve our simulation. But what was clear was that this was not really satisfying. So what we have done is to leave the charge to be fractional in a way. And actually, we fit, I think, properly these features, and we have seen that we have a fractional charge transfer from the alkali to the oxygen. So, namely, the oxygen anion should be -1, but actually, when we have the aggregation of these molecules in this structure, we have that we have a variation, fractional variation of the charge transfer around the oxygen. So aggregation change in a way the superoxide nature because of collective interaction within the solid. Another fact that we were able to simulate was the splitting in two different directions of the pi resonance in case of potassium oxide. Again, we have these features. We experimentally we had the split. Sorry, it is not well indicated. Anyhow, this is orthogonal to. Sorry. The axis of the oxygen, while parallel means parallel to the axis of the oxygen. And actually, we've seen that the fact that if we put enough atoms within the cluster, we were able to simulate splitting in two different the polarization in two different directions of this pi resonance. This is quite old work, but. Well, we were the first that could prove this splitting in this sort of solid. So, what's the meaning of all of that? That in case of low Z material, the Muffington potential can be used, even though it's not perfect, but can be used. We can successfully simulate the fine detail or the fine structure induced by the aggregation around the molecule, but what is important is to understand which is the correct ionic state of the anion and cation, and also how this is changed because in the framework of multiple scattering, because of the multiple scattering and the interaction among the different molecules within the solid. May I ask you if there are questions, or because now we go to the molecules, so this is a little bit different. Somebody wants to ask something, or I go on. Okay, nothing. So I go. Okay, now we will treat the molecular solid. Molecular solid are widely used to understand if in the photovoltaic mainly, but other in other field like spintronic and other and transport and let's say. The liquid or crystal or things like that, since they are very, very, very studied and seems to be technologically useful, let's say. Okay, what happens if we together molecules and form films or crystals, a single crystal of molecules? What happens is that these are the our molecule, as you have seen. We put these molecules together, even though the interaction are very weak, Van der Waals interaction, they form a different configuration of the solid. The electronic properties or the orbitals, as you like, are different. I remind you that the LUMO means lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, while HOMO means higher occupied molecular orbitals, and the distance between HOMO and LUMO is practically the gap of this semiconductor. And the alignment in heterostructure of these gaps is quite important from the technological point of view, transport, effects, and things like that. So it's not true that what we have in the single molecule is the same in case of aggregated molecules of the same type. Here, for example, we have a porphyrin, and we will see how they are built, but what is important is the fact that the gap from the experimental point of view is quite reduced, so distance HOMO and LUMO result quite reduced because of the weak intermolecular interaction in the solid. This, from the optical point of view, and this is quite important, is an optical spectrum, so it's absorption, but where the local density of state is between the valence band and the conduction band, and so no core level in this case, but the principle is similar. If you see in this, the single molecule, we have these features that are typically of these molecules. So this is so-called Soré band, and these are the Q bands. But anyhow, this is the configuration of the single molecules, meaning this. If we put together, so we have a solid, actually we have this blue stuff, where we have these other X, and these are the exciton. Why the exciton in this case are important? Because the transport in organic semiconductor is not related to the free carriers, as in silicon or silicon carbide or germanium and so on, but is related to the existence of the exciton. So the transport of the current is due to the moving of the exciton within the solid. So what happened to this? Okay, we have seen that we have splitting, and this again we have a splitting of the pi. These are the nexus, and this is the emission, and we have that the gap is reduced. All this to say that aggregation induces strong changes that are exploited in case of technological application. Now, we will speak in the following of the so-called porphyrinoid molecules. So these are flat molecules, practically, where the changes are due to the surrounding of the microcycle. In the middle, we have a transition metal, nickel, copper, and so on and so forth. All around, there are 4 nitrogen in case of porphyrin, or 8 nitrogen in case of phthalogen. Porphyrin is natural. Our blood is an iron porphyrin. Phthalogenin are artificially made. But anyhow, they have this configuration. The properties, because this system form a so-called conjugate system, are also induced in a way at the outer configuration of the carbon hydrogen atoms, so you can have different HOMO and LUMO position because not only of the microcycle configuration, but also because of the outer ring or radical of the molecule. Okay, so these are the two things we are going to use to discuss in the next application. Why these molecules are tricky? Okay, they can be used in several ways. Oxygen catalysis, because of this oxygen interaction, they can be used in also in spintronic and things like that. And also in spintronics applied also to photovoltaic and things like that. Now, depending on the central atom, we have different paramagnetic properties that are due to the fact that the central atom has a different electronic configuration. Here I show the thin film of copper, iron, copper, metalloxanin grown on, in this case, gold. As you see, this configuration, this L2, L3 nexus are different in the different case. Because the fact that the central atom interact with the surrounding, we have that this are an ion, and the electronic configuration of the 3D state is figured out by the nexus. So in case of cobalt, we have that the spin of the whole molecule, particularly of the central atom, is 1/2. This is also 1/2 in case of copper, and is 1 in case of iron, because there is a different occupancy of the 3D state that determine the paramagnetic property. So as you can imagine, the study of the L3 nexus is important to understand what happened when we use these molecules, in this case cobalt, phthalocyanin, we will see, in a different surrounding system. So we measure this back, as you have seen, and we try to apply the MXAN. Depending, so we started from the single molecule, and actually the single molecule was practically enough to simulate properly, let's say, the L3 cobalt shape. I remind you that we start from the 2p state, in this case of edge L3, and we arrive to the 3D state. So we are figure out how these magnetic orbitals are distributed. So as you see, we have this green stuff is the final field. It's not perfect, but give reason of the different configuration of the 3D state. In particular, the so-called A1G, practically is the TZ square orbital, that is this one, and in case of cobalt phthalocyanin is orthogonal to the in plane of the molecule, is properly figured out. What I mean, in this case, we tried the Dirac-Hara excited state potential. In this other case, we used the Hedin-Lund stick, but the excited state didn't work. So it's still something that do not understand. But the main part, meaning the polarization of the 3D state, is properly simulated by the MXAN. I remind you that once you have 3D state in a field that induce a sort of symmetry, you have a splitting of the 3D state that is schematized in this way, and the shape of the different orbitals is this one. In this case, it's particularly simple. Cobalt has its only state. So, meaning of that is that we are able to simulate by MXAN the L edges of transition metal, but still the details of the muffin tins are not so delicate, so so nice to manage to simulate at least the thin films. So what we are going to do, this is preliminary, what we are going to do is to increase the number of atoms into account also the other molecules close to this in the film, we will see if we manage to simulate properly this landscape. And here we pass to what happens if we induce perturbation because of aggregation. So again, film. We have seen that single molecule is not enough. So we have taken as example the zinc porphyrin. So here we have the zinc inside, four nitrogen ground, and then all the carbon, and the, this is called octaethyl porphyrin because there are ethyl group in the external part of molecules. First of all, coming back to the fact that single molecule configuration, single molecule calculation practically is not enough to simulate neither with DFT or with MXAN the spectrum. Because what happened to these specific molecules, but this is common also to other molecules, that if we have the isolated molecules in the gas phase, for example, or in solution, molecule is flat. So as you see, this is the side view, molecules is this one, and the ethyl group are up and down, the configuration of the molecule is flat. This specific porphyrin, fortunately, has only, and that's why we choose that, has only one morphism of the film. So there is only one configuration of the film. So other molecules like phthalogenin and other porphyrin has differences, polymorphism is called, for the moment forget it. What happened? That the isolated molecule, as soon as it aggregates, form a structure as a strong change of the external ethyl group, because they have a sort of chair configuration with this up and this down, and this because of the intermolecular interaction. Sorry that the figure is not very, very clear, but anyhow, this ethyl group parla with the nearest neighbor molecules here. You say, okay, but these are H bond, van der Waals. Why should be important? I don't know. But what I know is that, as I show you before, sorry, I have the formation, I have changes in the optical properties. So this should be important. It's not so small, the effect. So we wanted to see if the X-ray absorption can give us explanation of what happened to this molecule because of the structural changes of the aggregation of this molecule. As we have seen, we have changes. So only one technique is not enough to explain these effects, as I showed you before. Not only the gap change, but also the electronic states probably change, even though the interaction is very, very, very weak. And the magnetic properties, we have example in the literature, can change quite at all. And the dynamics of the carriers change a lot. This we know experimentally. So this is the motivation of the, of our study. So as you see, again, here we have the flat, isolated. Here we have the molecule within its natural structure in the film. And here we have that once I put together these molecules, actually these ethyl groups comes together quite closely. So something, some issue should happen. This is again this stuff. What happens if I measure nitrogen KH? So what we did is to play experimentally with the disorder. We characterize this disorder by means of diffraction. So we knew how big were the grains of ordered molecule, and we had an idea how much disordered was the sample. So in case of ordered molecule, so we have grains, is written in the paper, but anyhow, grains that are quite big, practically in all the diameter of the grain, ordered grains, is all the depth of the film, that is 1500 nanometer, and the line shape is deep. So again, we have I LUMO orbital or resonance, LUMO plus one, LUMO plus two, and the sigma, and the features are quite well. I didn't show here, but we have taken recently the gas phase, and this is quite similar, only slight shift in the LUMO and LUMO plus one phase with respect to the single molecule. If we have disordered, this feature shift a little bit, so it changed the position of the LUMO practically, but and there is a broadening of this feature. So as you see, details are not so clear with respect to the order film. But nothing else. So it's not really a strong. So in this way, the simulation of M sun that we have performed, again, this is a light set and this is a little bit tricky, but anyhow, when we try to simulate using always the heading loses excited state, but with neutral atoms, of course, we do not get good spectrum. We can imagine the feature, but the energy separation between the pi and the sigma is really poor, and also the line, the overall line shape is not nice. What have we done? Remembering what we have done in case of alkali oxide, we put the correct ionicity of the nitrogen. That's why, because when I have an anion in the middle of the structure or the microcycle is called, of course the nitrogen has to compensate the anion charge. So we left, by means of the program, a fractional charge that was possible. As you see, the here the broadening maybe is a little bit too high, but anyhow, we have a correct or possible position of high resonance, LUMO plus one, LUMO plus two, and also the sigma. So this way to calculate by changing the muffin pin zero, let's say, muffin pin potential in between the two holes, seems to work again this state, as in the previous case, the oxygen superoxide, and the alkali superoxide, sorry, and we managed to simulate this part before the continuum energy region. The problem is that we didn't see, at least at the nitrogen KH, any real change of the spectrum. Again, if I put this simulation, it's pretty good under this, I don't see the changes. It's always there, maybe the shift between the LUMO and the sigma, but actually it's not really satisfying. So we understand that in this case, we can have some information on the ionic state of the element, in this case, the nitrogen, but nothing else. Nothing that can provide information about the intermolecular interaction. Now, let's come back to the zinc, to the hard X-ray part of the central atom. As you see, we have again this and this. The problem here from the, if you see the spectrum, you are not so, it's not so clear. This state is only high resonance, and if there is the contribution also to this other state, and not perfectly P character, it's not as directional as in the case of pi. This because, as we have seen before, we have a different lifetime of the two species. If we compare the spectra of the nitrogen, one that I showed you before, the spectra of the zinc, actually, we see differences depending on the order. Especially this part starts to be part of the sigma. Here is weekly changes, but in case of hard disks, is different. We are studying to understand better why this is true. It seems that because of the wave function of the interacting photo emitted electrons, in this case, interaction with the surrounding is limited, probably with the line shape of the, with the wave function that is different with respect to this wave function that is like that the cluster where the multiple scattering take place is bigger. We do not have a final answer onto this. We are studying on that. But anyhow, empirically, I have changes in the case of the zinc edge that I practically do not have in the case of the soft X-ray. So, first of all, we had to understand if this L features was a pure L features or it was a sort of convolution also with other features. From the practical point of view, we have integrated intensity changing the pinching angle of the light. And what we have seen is a change that motivates the average orientation of the molecule in both of these. It seems different, but again, the polarization of the light in the case of the soft X is 100. So the E vector is completely polarized in the direction orthogonal to the direction of the light. In case of zinc, so N kilo electron volt, the beam line that we use is another, in another synchrotron, and is lower, it is 0.9, so the polarization is not completed. So it's the different polarization that motivate this change of this intensity. All this to say that we had a good, we were confident that this L state was actually the pure LUMO state, but we wanted to show that. So what we did, we applied the M-SAN both in this case onto the single molecule, and we increase the shells of the calculation. And actually, we have proved by means of the calculation that this L features has the correct polarization that is related to the LUMO state. So actually we confirmed by means of M-SAN that these measurements and the polarization of the light, the real polarization of the light can explain the orientation of the molecule. And actually this is the final more detailed things. As you see, case of order, we have a change in the LUMO intensity. This different in case of disorder that I didn't show here because it was too heavy figure. Anyhow, this goes to down and then goes to up. And this is similar in case of zinc. Taking into account the correct polarization, actually we have seen that both zinc and nitrogen just show that in case of ordered films, the molecules had an average orientation of 45 degrees with respect to the substrate, while in case of semi-order, this average was increased and actually the line shape was not perfect. Now, finally, we wanted to see if we could say something more about the intermolecular interaction in this field. So we have seen, as I told you before, the structural part is better figured out by the Hardwicks part. Or if you want, it seems that the scattering sphere of the multiple scattering is larger in case of the zinc KH. So we tried to compare without the fit the flat configuration with the other configuration of molecules, the one in the solid state, and actually we obtained without the fit changes in this part. So we decided to start a more detailed work by means of M-Xan of the zinc KH in these fields. So this is the diagram of the molecule. What we did was to leave the fit of the different spectra of the ordered one and of the disordered one. Here we obtain nice results. In case of disordered, what happened to disordered? This part is fixed, but this surrounding, in a way, is covered, interact with the nearest neighbor molecules. What we found, this is the spectrum, the dots are the spectra, is that to simulate this, not only a single molecule, but a shell up to this, up to the gray and yellow, the orange and yellow atoms was sufficient to properly simulate the fit. So it's something like this part in the disordered system was a sort of confusion that did not contributed with a resonance to the line shape of the zinc KH. This is different in case of ordered. In order to simulate properly this part, I had not only put a single molecule, but I had consider also nearest neighbor molecules and leave the fit running in this part. And we have seen that we had slight contraction and a slight increasing in the different carbon edge. Of course, hydrogen, I put the hydrogen, but I didn't work on the hydrogen too much. And what also important is that the microcycle, a little change, is not perfectly square, but is also is rectangular along this direction. So we interpret that as a real powerful opportunity by M-Xan to understand the details of something that is really, really, really subtle. That is the detail induced in the structure and in the electronic properties, because NEXAPS has both aspects, as we discussed before, in case of molecular oxygen. These are the results, as you see, in the different position, in different, so we had, in case of disordered system, we didn't get something that was really was enough to stop the configuration, so was not useful to change things out of this ring involved two carbon atoms, while in case of the ordered, we had a change of the symmetry. Why this is so important? Because there is a preferential direction of transport of excitons in these materials, and it has been proved by means of chemical changes of the radical of porphyrin that in case of photovoltaic application, the fact that the structure of the molecules became a little bit not symmetric increased the photovoltaic the photovoltaic performance. So I conclude my talk, maybe I run a little bit too much, but at least you can go to it. And the conclusion are, I list here the conclusion. So the bond length and the local electronic charges of the Z element result per tables in aggregate, and this is proved or is simulated, is modeled by means of MXAN. Particular care has to be made onto the potential. Of course, the possibility to have in the future a non-muffin tin potential could improve the model. Anyhow, we are able to get important information by using MXAN and multiple scattering. And in some specific case that are quite important in application, sometimes we can get information onto the intramolecular perturbation induced by the aggregation of this solid, and also practically help the researcher to understand how to improve, optimize the performance of this sort of materials. So I thank you, and I think that's all. If you want to put some question, I'm here.
Thank you, Maddalena. So we have a good amount of time for questions. So anyone? What we're doing when someone it's in a video conference, we ask the person to come here and to ask the question.
Yeah.
Okay.
Show grid the video. Okay.
Yes. So.
Now I see. No, I couldn't. So did I remove the sharing? Yes.
We're still seeing the slide. We're not seeing like the full screen presentation.
Okay. Yeah. So, because I don't get. Stop share. Sorry. Okay. Now is okay?
I guess. So anyone has a question?
Yeah.
So you come here? Yes.
So hello. Yeah. I actually do have a question to the slide where you showed the measurements of the...
Which one you want?
Of the zinc OEP.
Okay, just a moment. Do you see the
yes, we are seeing.
No, just a moment. I cannot get. Allora. I have to reduce this. Sorry. How can I reduce that? I don't know.
You want to put full screen?
No, not this.
It's
possible to see, yes.
Okay.
Anyways.
No, I remain like that, otherwise if I have to move, which slide do you want?
Yeah, it's the right one. So,
okay.
With ordered, you mean basically ordered so that the zinc OEP molecule orders like in some crystalline structure?
Order,
right?
I means that you see this, maybe I can quit. Sorry. This is the structure of the freezer. This is the structure of the crystal.
Yeah.
We measure by XRD the order how big were the grains of ordered cell within the crystal. Within the film, and this was of the order of 100 nanometer. That is a good feature. And order means that within the crane, the cell is ordered. So actually, all the mainly all the molecules are oriented in this way.
Mm-hmm.
This mean order. So has been measured by XRD. So I have parameters that say that this is order. Not only because there are other grain, but within the grain, this has this configuration.
So, okay, I get, so this is like long-range order, but what does
long-range, if I say diffraction means that I can measure the long-range order.
And then this order means, because it was not quite sure for me, because I mean these are like huge molecules, so I thought that they anyways will order somehow, so it's impossible to fully disorder them, so...
No, that's what I say. This sort of system, they are complicated, and you have to use multi-technique to understand the characteristic of the sample. If you want, I can show you the XRD. You want that?
Well, it's okay. I was just
anyhow, if you go to this physical chemist physical, you found the details practically. So anyhow, when I say order or disorder, is because I measured the long range order.
And then in the disordered case, you didn't get any long range order, but there will be still some significant.
No, only few. The coherent length of XRD. Here it say that I have very very small grains, and I see only a single peak in diffraction. Here I see all the of diffraction. It means that this here have there are here the molecules in the disorder are mainly oriented, but there are a lot of other molecules that are oriented in another way, and no long range order is present, but because of dimer, let's say.
Mm-hmm. And in the also for the spectra, so short range order doesn't really affect that.
We did XRFs, and here in the paper everything is written. Practically, XRFs can measure mainly the microcycle and up to the gray carbon. Mm-hmm. Cannot arrive up to here. That's a problem. Because this is pretty long, so so we have practically 10 angstrom between this and this. So if you use this as central atoms, so you do not arrive to say something about ethyl group. You arrive up to here. And in the PDF, I provide this table that give some results, but it's better that you read the original paper that we published. Anyhow, no time to say more. I wanted just to give you a hint of the results.
Okay. All right. Yeah, thanks a lot.
Oh, no, you're welcome. You can also, if you have a further question, you can write me, Didier and Ian, they have my email, so you can send an email and I can answer. The fact that I'm here and you are there, okay. So if you want, you can send me a question.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, anyone has another question? I actually have a question, Madalena.
Yeah.
You were talking about, because I'm not super familiar actually with using like multiple scattering, but I used to work with molecules, but more like TDFT and DFT, the conventional approaches. And usually with the you talked a bit about that. Usually with the porphyrins, you have a problem with DFT because these rings are strongly correlated, and you have it's hard to describe them with a single determinant. And do you think in the case of the multiple scattering, when you calculate this spectrus, it's less of a problem, do you think?
For NEXAF, maybe we can manage. That's what we are trying with Maurizio. In case of valence band and conduction band, let's say, I think that the GW is, for the moment, that best results, so we are in another space. For DFT, there are some simulation of Nexus, but I don't like them a lot.
Yeah.
The other possibility is the multiplex, but again, the effects of the intermolecular is impossible to get by means of the multiplex. It's not a direct result, while by means of EMTSAN or even by GW or DFT, you can understand a little bit more. For Nexus, again, for C60 was possible to simulate the Nexus by DFT, as I showed you before. Where is it? Here it was possible. I simply have taken the results of this PRB, quite old, and put below my spectra. And here it seems it's possible. But with other molecules, I think every case is specific.
I see.
So it's a tough work.
Yeah.
And that's why I prefer MXAN, because at least there I can fix or find something, the structure that I can verify by other techniques. By means of DFT, for me, is more difficult. I'm not a theoretician, no? But I have to understand. So we are working on it.
Okay, thank you. So, if we have no more questions... Ah, okay, there's one more.
Hello, Maddalena. Only a technical question. So, some molecules are quite open. So, do you insert empty spheres? And do you use a Watson sphere?
No, empty. No, we normally use the outer sphere, but we do not use empty sphere, at least up to now. For the moment. We are working on it. We will see. Ask... Hubert, ask Maurizio this afternoon. For the details, it's better to ask him.
Okay, we still have time if anyone wants to ask another question. Okay, no, so thank you, Maddalena.
Okay, so have a very, very nice time there, and I greet everybody.
Yeah, I'm sure we will.
Okay.
Maddalena,
yes.
Can you send the presentation as well?
I did already.
Okay. So it's fine. Yes. Thank you.
Okay. So ciao. Ciao, Bert. Ciao.